Well, John, thanks ever so much for joining us here at Sloth Coffee for a very special edition of Lifting the Lid on Swans TV, looking back at the 1994 Waterglass Trophy final, which you were the captain of the Swans that day. So we're going to go back through the day and your career and your life with some mementos from that time. So we're going to start you off, if that's right, mate, if you want to open the box.
No problem at all.
What we've got in there.
Let's have a look. Oh, the Macams.
So that's the programme from our game against Sunderland recently, which obviously you attended and you were on the pitch at half time there. You started your career with Sunderland, Whitley Bay boy. Could you just talk us through how you came to play for the Black Cats when you were obviously you were a grown up a Magpies fan?
Well, when I was a young'un, there was a few clubs wanting to sign us, and my dad was always quite keen for us to go around different clubs and have a look at different clubs. You know, all my family are black and white, and massive Newcastle supporters. Yeah. So when I says I was going training with Sunderland, a few of them weren't happy, to be honest with you. But they had a chief scout called Charlie Ferguson. He was a Scotsman. He had a little, I always remember, he was the worst driver in the world. He had a little red Fiesta. And on the way to train, you'd drive and he'd be like this, his clutch was like that. But on the way back, he was so smooth. And I didn't realise till I went into the room, he was on the whiskey for about an hour. So he used to drive us home on a Tuesday and Thursday night full of whiskey. But he signed... At Sunderland, he signed Ali McCoist. Okay, yeah. So I was in, esteem, people really that he'd signed. So I went to Luton with David Pleat. And I went to a few clubs, and there was a few clubs interested. But from the word go, Sunderland for me was the best club. And I just felt comfy with Sunderland. And thankfully, by the time I think I was 6 months out of leaving school, I played in the first division.
Yeah, because Len Ashurst gave you a debut at the end of that season. It was a tough time for the club, wasn't it? They were being relegated at the time, but obviously a massive day for you to make your debut in the
top flight. It was. I always remember the debut. We're standing in the tunnel, we're playing Ipswich, and I was a young, spotty teenager with a perm, right? I had a perm, and I'd played midfield all my life, and I'm walking out the tunnel, I'm looking up like that, and Terry Butcher was standing in the tunnel, and honestly, I was breaking it. The turnaround, and when we walked out, I'd forgot that I'd never taken a throw in for about 5 years because I was playing centre midfield, and all of a sudden I'm trying to take a throw in with this perm, and the first three throws I did three foul throws, didn't I? So, but it was amazing. It was amazing. I think we got beat 2-1 or 3-1. Kevin Wilson scored both goals. I think it was 2-1. But to play at Roker Park and the Roker Row, I'm a firm believer, and I think everyone's got to move on in the game, but the old stadiums for me have still got a place in my heart.
Yeah. And Sunderland is where you first worked with Frank Burrows. We'll talk about Frank in a bit more detail later on, but obviously a very important figure in your career.
Frank was, to be honest with you, Frank was my career. When I was at Sunderland as a reserve team player, Frank was reserve team manager. And obviously I was a ball playing midfield player. And he used to try and toughen us up by kicking us in training. And I always remember the day I got my perm, I went in on the Sunday morning for treatment, and he came walking in the treatment room, opened the door, and he, with his tash and his Scots accent, just looked and says, "I've just got you tackling now, you look like Shirley Temple." And but he was, from the word go, he was like, he was my, every, at Swansea they always used to say I was son of Frank. And they would always say, obviously he made his captain. I went in to see him when Jimmy Gillingham got injured, and I knocked on his door and says, "Can I be captain?" And he says, "I thought you'd have been in here 2 weeks ago." You know what I mean? So he played a massive part in my career, and I loved him, and I loved working for him. He was miles ahead of anyone as a coach.
So when it came to the decision to join Swansea, he would have been a big pull then, John. Yeah.
To be honest with you, he was the pull.
Yeah.
No disrespect to Swansea or anything, I didn't even know where Swansea was. I didn't know in the map. I wasn't very bright at school, to be honest with you. I knew the northeast, and I knew Swansea was in Wales, and my grandmother was born in Clontarf. Did I say that all right?
You did?
Yeah, Cardiff.
It was a bit close to Cardiff.
It was too close to Cardiff, to be fair. But it was, and to come down and drive, I drove down, and obviously the New York skyline, Port Talbot, you hit Port Talbot on the way in, and it was just, as soon as I arrived, I felt comfy with the place, and it's very, very similar to the Northeast. Yeah. The people are fantastic. You know, I mean, I stayed in the old Hilton, which is the McEwen now, and there's still some staff that are there when I signed in 91. But just the club and the walk, it was to be honest with you, it was magical to walk out in the Vetch.
Yeah.
And just look and see the Vetch, and I loved the Vetch. It was, but Frank was a massive part of my career.
Because we'll talk about obviously a lot about Wembley in this, but you mentioned old stadiums, you mentioned Roker Park, you've just mentioned the Vetch. Can you sort of describe to us what it would be like, night game at the Vetch, walking out from under the stand with the North Bank opposite you there, you know, what sort of memories does that bring back for you?
It was amazing. It was just turning up at the game, you know, I mean, you'd see all the staff, and obviously I know most of the staff that worked there, you know, Paul Draper and Jan selling the programmes and all these, and I'm still good friends with them all now, but to come out, especially a night game, especially the weekend of Welsh rugby, you know, the Friday night games are always amazing. You know, all the lads have been in the Garibaldi around the corner, they've been in the all the pubs around the ground, and it was buzzing. It was absolutely buzzing. But to be able to lead the team out, and the atmosphere was second to none.
Enjoyable. We'll see what we've got next for you then.
No problem.
All right, John, so we'll start to look at that 1993-94 season now in the lead up to Wembley. So if you want to take a
look
what's in the box.
Let's have a little look. Wembley. Evening Post.
Yeah.
John Burgum, eh?
Handsome guy in the front.
Remember
cover
John Burgum?
Yes, yeah. Nice. John still comes to our games now.
A few years ago, that, I tell you. No, it was amazing, and to look back, I must admit, I do watch the video a bit. You know what I mean? It's when you're a bit down, I put the video on and watch, and I was just proud of captain the lads, you know what I mean? It was a great team. To see some of the pictures in here and the run up to it was just unbelievable, really.
Yeah, there's a column from you in there, I think, John. Actually, see if I can just find it for you. There you are.
Oh, no, I managed to get a column because what I did was I used to get paid for it, and then I would pay for the lads to go out. I would pay for the lads and wives and that to go out for a meal. So I said I would do a column in the thing, but. I cheated a little bit because my dad was a sports editor of the South Shields Gazette.
Was he?
So I used to just send everything up to him. He used to just send it down to me, and I used to just give it to John Burgum.
Can you remember how much you got paid for it, John?
I can't remember. I really don't. But it's looking back, it's, you know, like that picture there, it's just unbelievable.
Yeah. I mean, in terms of that season as a whole, the previous campaign, you'd got to the playoffs, lost out to West Brom. There was quite a bit of expectation the side would challenge for promotion again. It didn't quite happen.
Aye.
So with that in mind, you know, how big did the autoglass competition become in terms of that success in that season?
The West Brom game and probably a couple of maybe a season later when we got beat off Birmingham in the playoffs was a massive downer for me. Yeah. I played all the way through the playoffs with a double hernia, and I was on an exercise bike half time to keep myself going, and I had to come off against West Brom, and obviously the big Westie got sent off, didn't he? And he was best man at my second wedding, so I can't really slag him off too much. But that was a massive downer. But to go into the season and Frank rejuvenate and bring another couple of people in and get the squad was just so tight knit from the word go. We used to socialise together. We used to have friends round. We used to have families together. I think after the Wembley final, I think there was something like 13 babies born, wasn't there? So there must have been some jiggy-jiggy going on after the Wembley final. Because I think Colin Pat, I think, well, in that year, seriously, it was, I think there was something like 10 or 13 babies born out of the squad. My son was born, Colin Pascoe had twins. There was actually, you'll have to find a picture, there's a picture about a year later of all the Swansea team, all with babies. But it was a magical, magical time.
Yeah. I mean, at what point, you know, it's a long competition, isn't it? There was a first round group stage, then knockout rounds. At what point in the competition as a squad do you start to think, you know, there's a real chance here, there's a real chance?
I thought when we played Leighton Orient away.
Yeah.
And I still get it mixed up. Did Sean Chappell score or was it Steve Tawtley?
I think you'd have a better recall of that than I
would. I think it's either Sean Chappell put Steve Tawtley in and he lobs the goalkeeper or vice versa. But when the ball went in Leighton Orient, because it was always a hard place to go to, I think it was Brisbane Road or something at the time.
Yeah.
But when we won that game, you started dare to dream a little bit, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then obviously getting Wickham. And we're 2-0 up the first leg. And to be honest, we were battered them. It could have been 3 or 4. I think Colin Pascoe and Jason Bourne scored. But it was, and then the lead up to it, I think the expectation around the town, they believed that we could do it, you know what I mean? Yeah. But the second leg at Wickham, Jason Bourne should have scored, I think, and nicked him through, and he was on the edge of the box, and the keeper made a good save. But I think they battered us for about the last 30, 35 minutes. Yeah. And thankfully we managed to hold on.
How did you feel at the end of that game to know you were going to Wembley? Because not every player gets to experience that. It was a very special thing.
The hype went up then. You know what I mean? I remember Frank, you'd always know on the way back if Frank was happy, because if we stopped off to get a couple of beers or something, he would let me get a couple of beers. And I would always try and buy him a bottle of white wine, because he likes white wine, Frank. So as soon as he said, oh yes, get us a bottle of wine, you knew for a fact you're all right.
You're okay.
And you'd probably get the day off the next day. So Frank had quite a few wines on the way home that night, I think. We ended up actually going to his house in Swindon. And I'm sure the bus stopped off and we ended up sitting in with Wendy, his wife, sitting having a glass of wine in his house, all the lads in the tracksuits, you know what I mean? So it was amazing time. It was amazing time. And then the lead up to Wembley,
yeah.
All the photograph shoots, I think there's a picture of me holding Hodges' ears, saying yeah. I'm going to lift the cup. You know what I mean? Hodges' ears were bigger than the handles on the cup, to be fair. But it was just, for the city and for the staff and everyone, it was a magical run-up.
Oh, we've got some more stuff to show you for the build-up to Wembley, John, so we'll move on to that now.
No problem at all. Brilliant.
So, John, the Swans have got to Wembley. The big day is fast approaching, so we've got a couple more little mementos for you to have a look at here.
Let's have a look. Couple of young lads there. Me and John Ford.
Yeah, on the pitch at Wembley the day before.
We'd actually walked, we'd gone down the day before. Is this Rogers? Is this what Rogers is doing?
Rogers gloves, yeah.
We'd actually gone down the day before and had a walk around Wembley and had a look at the dressing rooms, and I remember standing looking at the goal and saying, can you imagine if that's full and you're having to take a penalty? Because 9 days earlier, we'd played an unbeaten in the FA Cup, and we were losing 1-0 with about 7 minutes to go, and we got a penalty. And obviously, I took the penalties, and I went up and I kicked the ground, and it bounced about four times. So I ended up getting us knocked out of the FA Cup. It was my fault because I missed a penalty. So to go into Wembley and think, you've got to obviously think about penalties when you go into these big games. You know what I mean? So it was just magical. We went to the hotel, and Frank and the staff put beautiful food on. Old Ken, the bus driver, bless his soul, who died not long ago.
I think there's some good stories about Ken.
I've got a good couple of good stories about Ken. Me and Roger, when we used to go to away trips, we used to play crash cards at the back of the bus. And there was no sports science in all those days. The back of the bus, we used to have a slab of cheese, a big block of ham, white bread, and Branson pickle. So that's what we used to get, Branson pickle ham and cheese sandwiches. So Ken used to get on the thing and say, Corny, Roger, make us a Branson pickle sandwich. So we used to get the sandwich, and I used to get the playing card and stick it inside his sandwich. So he's driving along like this, biting his playing card. But the night before, he would never have a drink, because obviously we used to go up and back in the at the same day with Swansea. They didn't have much money those days. So I said to Roger, I said, Ken's left his key by the bar. I says, come on, let's do his room. So me and Roger went up to his room, and we unscrewed the legs on his bed and just balanced the legs on his bed. And he was having a few pints with Frank. Frank was making him have a few pints. And then we cling filmed the toilet, didn't we? So he'd gone up there and we heard a massive thud. The bed had collapsed and all this. And he'd gone to, I'm not saying what he did at the toilet, but it was, in breakfast was a, it broke the ice in the morning, all the lads having a laugh and carry on. And but it was, we got up and I was, every game we went to, I would always like to go in with the kit man to the game. You know, if we stayed in a hotel, I would like to go in, I would like to have a walk around and choose what studs I would have to wear and just get a sense of it. But obviously the Wembley thing, you couldn't.
Yeah.
But just pulling up at Wembley, and I had 56 come down on a bus from the northeast, and we pull up, and they'd been on the drink since 5 o'clock in the morning from the northeast, and we pulled up, and they're standing outside, all the lads from my mum and dad, my brothers. To see them before I walked in, it was special, like, but the atmosphere was unreal.
Just to take you back a step from travelling to Wembley, what was the build-up in the week like? So different feel around training. I'd imagine your phone might be ringing off the hook, people wanting tickets.
The tickets I had to sort out for all my family and things, but Frank tried to keep everything similar. You know what I mean? If you try and change things, it's difficult. You know, Frank would do daft things like have a biscuit eating competition. He'd have like six digestives on the thing, and Roger would win every week. So any new player, any young lad would come in, you're taking on Roger, and Roger would just like, he would disappear. Yeah, yeah, yeah. He'd be swallowing them whole, Roger, you know what I mean? And we'd do daft things like that. I think he took us to a leisure centre, and we went for a swim and things like that. And just, you know what I mean? We were better when we're out training. You know what I mean? Players, your Pascos and your Kwame Ampadus and Torbys. And obviously, I was very, very sad that Keith Walker, who was a fantastic player, Sky, he was either injured or suspended for the cup final. So that gave Michael Basham his chance, you know what I mean? And you know, people like Mark Harris, Chopper Harris, and I don't think they got enough credit they deserved because they were such good players, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I used to train at the old Moorover Stadium. Some supporters will have no recollection of what that is, but it was just the other side of the river, obviously, from where the Swansea.com stadium is.
Well, it's at Moorover Stadium, the pitches were horrendous. And, but every second afternoon, because I was never the quickest, you would have Frank's friend was Ken, I can't remember his second name, he's an Olympic sprinter or something, sprinted for Wales. Okay, yeah. And he'd have me in the afternoon with a bloody parachute on my back trying to sprint like this, and I hated it. I absolutely hated it. But the atmosphere, the Moorover, and we'd get up there and, you know, Bobby Smith was Frank's assistant and he'd put sessions on. And even when before I left, I think I've got recollection of Jan training there, Jan Mulby as well. Yeah. But, you know, we trained there, Frank was very good with. He'd want pattern the play, he'd do a lot of homework on the opposition, and he was miles ahead of himself, but he would keep everyone on a level keel, you know what I mean, and keep your feet on the ground, which was good.
And is it right that Ken, the coach driver as well, was a bit disappointed he didn't have one of the club tracksuits for Wembley, but is it right that Frank actually sorted one out
Frank had sorted out for him, so he's sitting in his tracksuit with his shiny black shoes and his a couple of pints, and Ken was a diamond. He was, you know what I mean, people behind the scenes, you know, that's what make football clubs for me. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's the people that are selling the programmes, the people that worked in the Harry Griffiths bar, the bless them, the person who had to clean the Harry Griffiths toilets, I wouldn't fancy that. You know what I mean? It was horrendous in there. But the Vetch was a magical, magical place. You know, our players' lounge was half the size of this room. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's we had to stock the cans myself. You know what I mean? There was no, we had to go to Macro or whatever and get our cans myself to stock for the family and friends, but that's what made it the Vetch special, you know what I mean? It's I know I shouldn't really say it, but I ended up getting the keys for the director's bar in the thing, and Robin Sharp didn't know. So when we used to go out in the Swansea, and we used to come back in, and we used to go back in the director's bar and have a little bit of a lock in, and come in the morning, where's everything gone? And me and there'd be a few of the lads in, but the place itself was just not just the city, the staff, the team. I was very fortunate to captain. I was very proud of captain. Yeah. It was just, like I've said before, it was a magical time.
Right, well, match day is nearly here now then, John, so we'll get you and the boys to Wembley in your very dapper suits in a second.
Happy days.
Right, John, so we've had the picture of you walking on the pitch of Wembley the day before, so you've got something for the match day itself. You can have a quick look at you.
It's not the trophy yet then.
Not yet.
Oh, look at the smart lads. Oh, Dickie Jones, aye.
So I see you and the guys in your club suits on the pitch of Wembley pre-match. So there's a bit of a different feel about that to the one from the day before, was it? Quite relaxed, the one with John Ford the day before, but there's a bit of nerves there, I think, would be fair to say. A bit of excitement.
Excitement?
Yeah.
I never got nervous. Yeah. The only time I got nervous, I think, was when I joined the Welsh squad. And there were so many stars there, and I was just like a nobody, really. I mean, but The Wembley day, getting to the thing and seeing all the Swans fans, and it was unreal. It was just what you become a professional footballer for. You know what I mean? And all the lads looked really smart. We went for the suit fittings in somewhere in Swansea. I'm getting old. I can't remember where we got, but the lads looked immaculate. You know what I mean? And it was special. It was leading up to it. It was the right time for us.
So can you remember what your match day morning was like? Did you have any superstitions, any rituals? Well, I've, different for
I've always, all my career, I've always had like beans on toast for pretty much. And later on when sports science came in and I was retiring, the Wickham physio turned around and says that you can't have beans, it's got too much sugar in. So I used to take my own cold tin of beans and just pour it on the thing. I would have to, I was one of them that would have the same thing all the time. Some lads would get up for breakfast and have a full breakfast. Some lads would then just have a cup of tea or a cup of coffee. For pre-match, you'd normally have pre-match 12 o'clock. But I wouldn't have breakfast. I would always get up and have a walk or a stretch, and then I would have pre-match. I'd have beans on toast. And then obviously, they would normally sit in the same seats on the way back. But that was mainly because the back thing was where we used to play cards. You know what I mean? So all the experienced ones used to sit at the back, and all the youngins used to sit at the front. But it was just magical. Going up, it was like the old Wembley. Yeah. You know what I mean? So. The real Wembley, it was the real Wembley, you know what I mean? So it was, so what was the Twin Towers. And
yeah, what was the bus journey like?
Oh, it was just amazing. You know what I mean? Obviously, you've seen the Huddersfield fans and you got a little bit stick off them, but to see the Jack Army there, it was amazing, unreal.
Did you say, John, that you give your suit away to a charity?
No, I lost my suit.
Lost it, okay. Sorry.
Would one at Wembley, I'd give my shirt away to a charity.
Yeah.
But would, obviously, typical... Swansea, we didn't have much cash or anything. Yeah. We'd had loads of, there was loads of champagne on the bus on the way back after winning it. But then we stopped in Membury Services for a pie or a McDonald's or something. And all the Swans fans were there. So when we got off the bus, I just got mobbed. I lost my tie. I ended up going back on the bus with my boxer shorts on, my socks. So it was unreal. It was, you know what I mean? Looking back at it, you know, 30 years ago, it makes you feel old, but it was fantastic memories.
Lighter suit as well. That Liverpool got into a bit of bother a couple of years after that, didn't they, for their white suits? So the original Spice Boys there.
No,
right?
There was, to be fair, that we started all off. The Liverpool lads looked like Boyzone or something. Liverpool lads, didn't they?
Right, well, there were 18,000 Swans fans in attendance there that day, John, so we'll ask you in a minute what it was like to walk out in front of them. Okay, John, well, you're 1994, you're about to lead the team out at Wembley, so you've just got a little something to remind you of something that was a bit different about that final that day.
Oh, unbelievable.
So as we said, there were 18,000 Swans fans there, and because there was a Welsh club in the final, the Welsh national anthem was played beforehand as well.
Oh, it was unbelievable.
So what do you remember of walking out, and what was the feeling for you and for the team? So as you leaving the dressing room and the old long walk out from behind the one goal at one end, wasn't it?
It was just pride, really, and to see how many Swans fans were there. It was, and you know, it doesn't matter whether there's 18,000 or two Swans fans, they're out-sing the opposition, doesn't it? So yeah. It was unbelievable. It was breathtaking in a way. And obviously see your family there, and I mean, it was class, it was really good.
And you know, how much noise were those supporters making when you're out doing your warm-ups, and you know you're getting a bit closer to kick-off?
Oh,
and
unreal. You know, obviously, credit to Huddersfield as well. Huddersfield brought, you know, thousands and thousands, didn't they? So it's, but just for the Swans to go along the M4, and obviously I've watched all the videos. I watched Spielberg's videos and all that from the bar and all that. The lads stopping at all the services that have been sent all them. And to see how happy the fans were, and for me to be the first captain ever to lead a Swans team out of Wembley, it was good.
And you know, a bit different from a normal sort of pre-match as well. You know, I think Michael Howard was the Home Secretary at the time. You had to introduce him to the team. What was that like? Because we wouldn't be used to introducing someone to your team before you go and kick off.
I just told them their nicknames, man. I can't repeat on camera what I was calling some of them. But it was nice to walk them through and obviously introduce them to Frank and the mascot. And I was sent a picture of the mascot not long ago. He's got his own kids and all that now, and all in the Swans kit. And it's amazing, unbelievable. It's a fantastic story.
Yeah, and after all that build-up, once all that's finished, is it almost a relief where you can go and play football?
It is. It's, you know, I was a very vocal captain, and I would bang a few heads, and I was like that. So it was game time. You know what I mean? So
yeah. Can you remember what you said to the team before kickoff?
I can't repeat it. but it was positive.
Yeah.
It was
positive. Yeah. I just want to ask you about Wales as well. You're capped by Wales, John. As you said, grandmother was from Llantrisant.
Yeah.
You know, how how proud are you to play for Wales on the biggest stage? And obviously, your association with Swansea as well.
Unbelievable. It was. I always remember the day Frank called me in the referee's room at the Vetch. And obviously, if anyone's been in the referee's room at the Vetch, you know, you can't get more than two and a half people in. That's why Keith Cooper used to referee a lot, because he was only about that tall, wasn't he? But to be honest with you, he pulled us in just as Mike Smith's been on the phone.
Yeah.
And I know this sounds awful, but I says, who's Mike Smith? And he says, he's the Wales manager. And I went, oof. I says, he says, they've gone from parents to grandparents. You're flying to Moldova on Tuesday. And typical, I said, where's Moldova? I mean, so I can see why I got sent to Moldova when a few of the lads faked injuries, I think, because it wasn't the nicest of places in the world. But to get into the training camp, and like I said earlier, it was the first time I'd ever really been nervous to walk in, and Dean Saunders, Gary Speed, rest in peace, was the nicest man you'll ever meet, one of the best players you'll ever meet. Ryan Giggs, Neville Southall, Ian Rush, Mark Hughes, Kevin Phillips, Chris Coleman, Melville, all the lads. It was just, and once you'd trained with them, and once you'd gone out, and we'd meet up in Waltham Abbey in London, and then you'd realise that you'd go to the grounds at night time, and then you'd have a few pints, but that was football of those days, and it was a social side as well. But it was amazing. You know, I went to Moldova, I went to Georgia. I was on the bench quite a few games in Germany away, and places like that. You know, so I've experienced a lot with Wales, but I eventually got my first cap away in Bulgaria. Stoichkov, I was sitting on the bench clapping like that. Stoichkov was tinting on his chest and pinging it 70 yards. And it was just to watch these players, and then all of a sudden from the callers and say, you know, you're going on. And then I made my full debut against Georgia. Vinnie Jones got sent off after about 10 minutes, and Georgia just played keep ball around us for about 75 minutes. But to make your debut, and then Bobby Gould took over, and he told us I was going to get a run in the team. But we played Carlisle on the Friday night before teaming up, and Bobby Gould and Frank had asked if myself and Roger, who were in the squad, could play in that game. And I went for a header 94th minute, and I did my knee ligaments. And that was the end of that.
Moldova, that's the famous story of the cockroaches in the beds and all that sort of stuff.
I'm not joking. We went in the bathroom. There was like a brown piece of cloth on the towel rail. And I was rooming with Jason Bourne, and Bourne goes, where's that come from? And I says, yeah, come out here and looked. And they just cut it off the curtain. They just cut it off the curtain like that and left the curtain hanging and just hung it over the thing. But it was horrendous. Obviously, thankfully, they used to take their own chefs and things, so the food was nice. But the training pitches and everything was ridiculous. The Bulgaria game where I made my debut, there was 5 foot of snow on the pitch in the morning when we got there, and they got the Bulgarian army in. And when we were there, they were just, by the time you got the game, night time, it had all been cleared. It was, but it was to, you know, friends for life, a lot of them. It's, you know, I see Big Nev about, and he's what a goalkeeper he was, and what a person he is. He's such a nice man. But all of them were really down-to-earth, genuine lads, you know what I mean? Barry Horn and people like that were really good.
We'll take you back to Wembley next, John, and we'll actually go through the game with you next.
No problem at all.
Right, John, so underway.
You're going to look at my box there, aren't you?
Yeah. So you want to see what's in there next?
Aye. Oh. The famous cap.
Famous cap. So, Roger Freestone was the goalkeeper that day. He's quite famous for wearing a baseball cap, quite a bit with the sunburns in his eyes. There can't be too many goalkeepers who've come away from a Wembley final, not just with the key save in the shootout, but actually having an assist in the game. So, before we talk about Andy McFarlane's goal, can I just ask about Roger? Obviously, the club's record appearance maker. What was he like to play with and to have a keeper of his calibre behind you?
Roger was outstanding. Absolutely outstanding. Everything he did, he was... me and Roger were the bigger lads, the more rotund lads, and we used to get fined for putting weight on and things like this. But we'd always been the same all of our career, so we used to always train with a black bin liner on and get a good sweat on. So, but I remember I loved him. I loved him a bit. So I just thought he was the best goalkeeper in the league by a mile for many, many years. Yeah. And obviously he took penalties. He was getting too good at the penalties. I was worried that Frank was going to take me off the penalties at one time. But he was just, the amount of important saves he made and the important, he'd shank the ball out of play quite a lot, and Frank would go and throw his cap down and go mental at him. But he was a great lad. He was an absolute great lad. But fantastic goalkeeper.
Yeah.
I got a little story about Roger. I remember we were playing. It was my Wales debut. I'd been told I was starting against Georgia, and I was rooming with Roger. So in the afternoon, we'd gone for lunch, and I'd gone in to have a sleep before the game. Just not enough to sleep. And everything in Wales, everything was paid for. You got everything for nothing. Yeah. So there was a bang at the door, and this fella came walking in with a trolley with about 14 meals on. Roger had ordered the full menu, and he's sitting, he used to love a cigar, Roger. He's sitting on the bed with a cigar like that, just eating this food. And I'm trying to get ready for the game, you know what I mean? But he was brilliant. I can't say what I was saying earlier about him with the hotels, but he was a diamond. He was good crack. Yeah. He was very much a home boy. Yeah. That's why I think when he left Chelsea, he came to Swansea, and I think he liked, was it Caldicott or something?
Newport.
But I think he loved the Welsh setup, and I think his wife and his kids were happy and settled. But for me, he was streets ahead of anyone in the league as a goalkeeper.
Yeah.
But for me, he was a better man. He was lush.
Yeah.
Class.
Yeah, top man. As you say, he had the assist for Andy McFarlane's goal. And there'd been a bit of talk there whether it'd be McFarlane or Torpy who started up front. But, you know, how much of a nerve settler, I feel like, is it? You get a goal like that, you take the lead, you're not chasing the game, you're in front of Wembley.
Well, to be honest with you, it was quite tight the first
5-10 minutes,
and both teams had quite a lot of the ball. But when the ball goes back to him, and I've watched it so many times, he gets a good connection on it. They miss out, and Andy McFarlane gets through, and I think everyone was more shocked that he showed some composure, to be fair. Big Mac. He showed a little bit of skill and finished it off. You know, I mean, he used to live, when I lived in Cosignan, he lived in the same estate as me, and 1 o'clock in the morning, you'd get a knock on the door, and he'd be asking for a pint of milk. He was like so laid back. I don't think he knew what time it was. I don't think he never had a watch. He was that type of person. But he scored some important goals for Swansea, Macca. And he was a great lad. Ex-kickboxer, ex-bouncer and all that, and he's it was a great start for us, absolutely fantastic start.
Yeah, and you know, in terms of Frank's management, you know, big decision, but made the right call.
He never,
Steve obviously scored in the shootout as well.
Frank was like hard as nails, but Frank was, like I said earlier, he was miles ahead of himself coaching wise, and you know, I remember one time me and Jason were injured for a game, and he sent us down, and we ended up going in an oxygen chamber. You know what I mean? I'm watching this thing on Netflix at the minute. All the footballers have got them in the house, but we had to go to an army camp and sit with blankets around us. Me and Jason, I think we're playing Stockport away first game of the season, and I declared myself fit, and Boz says he was injured, and I think we got beat 5-0. So I wish I'd stayed in the oxygen chamber, to be fair. But Frank was amazing, and he didn't get many things wrong. You know what I mean? He was positive in everything he did. If people stepped out of the line, he would nail them, and you knew where you stood with him. He was an honest bloke. Yeah.
So Richard Logan equalises for Huddersfield, and then right at the death,
Roy
the Rover.
If you watch the video, which I've watched and I giggle at all the time, I put the ball down to take the free kick, and Colin Pascoe comes over and tries to grab the ball. And I said something to him. I can't tell you what I said, but I said something to him. And you'll see his face. He like goes like that. He walks away upset, doesn't he? But I bent it over the wall, and I was turned away. I thought I'd scored. And Parks made an amazing save. So then, obviously, you go to extra time. I tweaked my calf during extra time, and I was limping a little bit. And I was a little bit worried that Frank had noticed and take us off. But I think he knew it was going to penalties. And then obviously the big penalty shootout.
Yeah, so you know, you mentioned the miss against Nuneaton 9 days previously.
Yeah.
But as captain, as penalty taker, did you feel the responsibility of I'm taking the first one? It's going to be me who has the first one, no one else. I'm not going to wait till later in case there's a push penalty later. I'm going to set it off.
100%. I always said I would take the first one. And obviously they missed.
Yeah.
Roger had saved, or it hit the crossbar. Starbuck, wasn't it?
Yes,
Phil Starbuck,
right.
hit the crossbar, and it come across, and it went all the way in front of the Huddersfield fans. So those days, there was no ball boys around, so I had to hobble over to the Huddersfield fans, and I tried to do a little chicken flick it up, and I tweaked my calf again. But I caught it and they were all having a go at it. So I went and I put the ball down. And I always says I would just be positive. And so I think looking back, I took the longest run-up in the world. But I just connected with it and they were in the top corner.
How does that feel then? What's that feeling scoring a penalty shootout at Wembley? Silverware on the line. You're the captain, your first of your team.
A lot more relief than none eaten 9 days earlier.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it was just to get one on the board, which scored.
Yeah.
And then obviously you're closer to winning it, really.
Yeah, and Swansea scored all three of theirs and they missed three of their four.
Aye.
So when Roger makes that save and you know it's all done. Well, Roger says he didn't know it was done. He thought there was still another penalty to come.
If they keep taking penalties, Roger just keeps saving them. You know what I mean? He's quite happy saving them. But no, we won on the halfway line and we'd realised, you know, we'd won it, so it was good.
So what emotions go through you? What's in you? You know, can you remember what goes through your head in that moment when you know you've won?
I was just worried about my calf walking up those stairs. No, I'd gone over to Frank, but obviously because I'd known Frank since I was a young kid.
Yeah.
And it was just, it was touching, to be fair. It was really good.
All right, John, if you want to lift the lid once again.
Here we go. There's the main man.
The main man, yeah.
Frank and Dougie Sharp.
Yeah, Frank Burrows and Doug Sharp.
To be honest with you, Sharp, I think Sharpie got a lot of stick, mate, but I thought he was class. I loved him. I really did. Obviously, he had his offices up in Gosani where I was living. But there was one pre-season I was injured and there was a lad that gone, Frank had taken him away and I was negotiating a contract. So Frank had more or less left me and Doug to negotiate a contract. So we'd spoke and we'd banged heads together for 2 or 3 days. Yeah. But I've seen him a few times since. I've seen him in airports around the world. Yeah. And he's always got his Val Dunican jumper around, his golf jumper. But I thought he was a top, top man, Doug Sharp. And I couldn't speak highly of him. But obviously this with Frank and the amount of times I've seen him sling this on the sideline and it was his trademark, wasn't it?
It was, and
but I've talked about him, he's the best I've ever worked for. You know, I've played for some good managers, I've played for some bad managers, but you know, there's good managers motivating people and good managers coaching, and then there were some just awful managers, and Frank was hard. He was hard but fair.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he would look after everybody. He would always be there for if you need to knock on his door at the vetch field. And the only thing I didn't like towards the end was he had a mirror when he lost a bit of weight. And he had a mirror, and you were taunting him, and he'd be looking at himself in the mirror and putting his tie right. And that. But he was brilliant. He was just everything about him, his training, his match day preparation, his humour. But he was he was ruthless. He was really ruthless. I remember going to, I think we went across to, did we go to Finland?
Well, yes. You'd know
yes.
Than me,
I think we went to Finland. We went to Finland pre-season, and he'd said to the lads, "You can get yourself out and have yourself a beer if you want to. Have one beer and come back." And me, Colin Pascoe, and Keith Walker, I think it was, come back a little bit later than the lads. And the next day he named the team and we went. He just didn't even give any warning. Just, we were on the bench. He just go and warm the goalkeeper up and the three were going to go and warm the goalkeeper. And we just got ostracised for a day. But it learned you a lesson, you know what I mean? And I'm a firm believer. And he's from signing and playing in Sunderland Reserves at 15 and a half, 16. And Frank taking over my career there and then coming 370 miles down the country to Swansea, having an unbelievable career at Swansea and loving the place and still love the place. And it was all to do with Frank. And obviously when Frank left, it wasn't the same. The club wasn't the same. It just, there was a massive void. And obviously Big Jan took over and he gives us a good mention in his book saying that he had to sell us because obviously he offered that much money from Birmingham. Yeah. But the real reason was that there was only one big pair of shorts and he wanted to carry on playing. And to this day, that's the reason why he sold us. I know that for a fact, because we're both on a big arse.
That's an exclusive for Swans fans.
Exactly.
You know the truth now.
Exactly, that's the truth. He didn't sell us to Birmingham for the money. It was the one big pair of shorts and he wanted to carry on playing.
Right, we've got the main event for you next, John.
Yeah, no problem.
Right, John. So you've won silverware with the Swans at the club's first ever visit to Wembley. You're going up to the Royal Box. We've got something a bit special to show you now.
Unbelievable. Oh, look at that one.
Hi. So that's the picture of you lifting the trophy there.
Amazing. To play at Wembley, to lift the trophy, to get man the match, to score a goal, it was dreams come true, really. Dreams come true.
So what do you remember about, from the final whistle to coming up here to getting your medal and lifting the trophy?
It was when we walked up the stairs, there was a lot of like VIP but Swans fans. So they were all grabbing you and putting scarves around you and hats on you and things like this. But obviously me and Dodge Day, you know what I mean? Yeah. But I think this was Gordon McKeague or something when I won.
Gone to the left by there, yeah.
There's the main man I was just talking about, obviously Sharpie.
Doug Sharp, yeah.
And Robin behind. But it was amazing, and the Swans fans, the singing for the next half hour was unreal, like, unreal.
So what was it like back in the changing room then? How did the celebration start? Are these stories safe to share?
I missed it. Because obviously, as soon as you finish, I had to go and get my man the match award. I had to go and get my man the match champagne. Then me and Frank were carted off to do the interview.
Yeah.
So we went in with all the press and we sat for another, me, Frank, Neil Warnock and his captain, and we sat for probably about another 35, 40 minutes answering questions. And then I had to go outside and asked to do another interview. And then when I come back in, Frank had opened me man the match champagne, was drinking me man the match champagne. So I had to get back in touch with Autoglass and ask them for another bottle of champagne. So to be fair to them, they sent it. But the atmosphere in the dressing room was just unbelievable. Absolutely, it's just really mental. And then the funny story is, I come out and I'd had the man the match champagne and I give it to my dad and all my family were outside. Yeah. And they had all Welsh flags, all the Swansea fans, they gave them all Welsh flags because they knew we're family. And on the way home, they had been on the drink since 5 o'clock in the morning, they'd watched the final, they'd actually climbed down four sections to get by the pitch. Yeah. And there's a picture in my local in Whitley Bay of me holding the man the match award and all the lads are behind. Yeah. They'd been elbowing kids out the way and all this to get to the front. But on the way home, they'd passed the Huddersfield coach up there, and they must have thought, by the drunk, they're going the wrong way. But no, they had the Welsh flags like this, and they're giving all the Huddersfield players, and apparently they're all just sitting like somber because they'd lost.
Yeah.
But it was just magical. It was amazing. Yeah. And then back to earth with a bump. You had when training the next day.
Yeah, obviously your suit didn't survive the journey back there. No. What was it like when you go back to Swansea? Was it on from there?
Oh, it was. I can't remember where I went. I think. To be fair, we were so quite late back coming back after all the rigmarole, and we had a game Tuesday night. So we'd had a good drink on the coach, and there'd been plenty of champagne and things on the coach. I think Frank had more or less says home. So our wives or whoever picked us up, took us home, and we're in the next day. You know, sore heads, but obviously there was a big bath at the vetch, and we'd get in a bath, and Frank was well into the getting people massages and things like that, even in those days, you know what I mean? So we'd go and get a massage and then rejig, and we played Port Vale on Tuesday night and got beat, which we got an absolute slaughtering for. He slaughtered us. But I think we had about four or five games in the space of 10 days after that. And I think it took a week or so to get the champagne out of the system, to be honest with you.
Was it really booed off as well? There was a few boos at full time in that Port Vale game.
There was a bit booze.
Come back with
I
the
don't know about the booze.
But
no, to be honest with you, I think we were. I think we're so bad. I think he brought a couple of the like reserve team players in, but he brought us off the bench. I was on the bench. I remember coming off the bench. But I think it was just one of those things where he'd been on such a high.
Yeah.
You couldn't get yourself going. It was very, very difficult. You know what I mean? But it was from start to finish, from the run from Plymouth away, all the way to the final, to you know, from my point of view, to lead Swansea out for the first time, to get man the match, to score a goal, to lift the trophy. It was just what it's like a Hollywood movie. You know what I mean? It's just like things are made of, really.
Because you're a title winner at Sunderland earlier in your career. I mean, where does this rank? Where does this rank for you?
To be honest with you, I was in and out at Sunderland, and I didn't play particularly great at Sunderland because when you're not playing many games, you're in the reserves and that. And to win the third division medal at the time, it was all well and good, and I'm very proud of it, but this was massive. This was the biggest thing in my life. far from my kids being born, you know what I mean? And it was just, it was amazing, absolutely amazing day.
You played on for a few more years, John, then moved into coaching. We've been out of football for a bit now, because we moved into working in clothing and retail.
When I come back from abroad, I was the awareness manager for cancer research for 6 years, so I worked direct with the nurses. And my wife had started a clothing business, studiobsunderland.com, if you want to buy any clothes. we've got a couple of shops and we've got the website that posts all over the world, and it's a lot of the Swansea girls who I know down here buy a lot of stock off us. So it's hard work, but it's good. It's a family business. We've just gone into interiors again, which is opening this week. Yeah. So it is difficult. It's a far cry from obviously training every day, and I still try and go, and I'm at the gym most mornings and try and keep my legs going, my knees going on the bike and things, but as you get older, your joints and your ankles never done that, do you know what I mean? But I miss even just driving to Swansea today. I got a magical feeling coming over the bridge, and obviously being at the ground tomorrow to see. I've never seen many games in Swansea since I've left, and I might have a little walk over the vetch and have a little look.
Yeah. And the tracksuit that you're wearing there is a very special remake of the one that you'd have worn in 1994, which supporters will get a bit more of a glimpse of in the coming days after this interview goes out. But just, what does it mean to you, 30 years on, you know, the club is sort of marking the anniversary of, you know, a very important day in the club's history, you know, 30 years first game at Wembley.
I've been quoted a couple of times saying that I thought the Wembley team was the forgotten team. Yeah. If you walk around the new stadium, I think we've got one picture around the radiator and the ticket office. You know what I mean? And I think that's all you got of the Wembley team. And I've said that in the past, and that's obviously me protecting my team. And I've thought that for years, and for this to happen, where you can get some of the lads back together who, you know, weren't paid fortunes, didn't get paid much. You know, you get a 25 quid a week rise if you've done well in all this, and a lot of it was your appearance money and your bonuses if you went far in the competition. But it means the world to us. It's, you know, to get back together, and for me to come down here now, to be back in the place I love, Swansea. It's amazing to pull the tracksuit on. It's obviously a little bit bigger than the one I wore in Wembley, but it's fantastic. It's what I've been crying out for years for the Wembley team. I think they should be recognised more.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, John, thanks ever so much for taking the time to sit down with us.
All right.
It's good to see you back in Swansea.
Thanks, man. Thanks a lot.